Hello, anatomy friends. It is Dr. Alsup again, and we are going to talk about muscle attachments and their significance, basically their functions. And there are a lot of terms we are going to work through together, but having a running knowledge of this terminology will really help in some of our later conversations regarding specific muscles. So muscle attachment sites. What I mean here is the sites or the locations that a muscle will actually connect or attach to the bone. So when I say the muscle really what I'm talking about is the muscle tendon attaching to the bone. And when a muscle contracts, one of its attachments usually remains fixed, or in other words, that bone doesn't move, while the other attachment site does move, and it's typically pulled toward the immovable attachment site. With the more traditional terminology, the immovable attachment site is referred to as the origin, so the part that is going to be stationary, or the site that will be stationary, and these tend to be more proximally or superiorly placed, whereas that movable part or that movable attachment site is referred to as an insertion, and these tend to be distal or inferior. But for some muscles, sites can be movable depending on, for some muscles, it can be dependent on the action as to which site will be movable and which site will not. And so that really would change the meaning, or the main meaning, of the origin insertion. So there's been a movement in anatomy textbooks away from the terms of origin and insertion and more towards the more descriptive proximal and distal attachments. So when we're talking about the individual muscles and their attachment sites, you will typically, in my area, see on the slides more proximal and distal. But change is slow going, and many people, like this person who happens to be talking right now, learned origin and insertions. So it's hard to kind of teach an old dog new tricks, so you will likely hear me using both sets of terminology. But I promise I'm trying, and I will tend more towards these in the slides. Alright, so if we're looking at, say, the biceps brachii, you see that there are two proximal attachment sites, two tendons attaching more proximally, and then you have one tendon that's attaching more distally. For any action that occurs, there are typically more than one muscle involved. Likely, there are very many muscles involved, and these muscles will have different roles or different functions to allow the most efficient movement possible. So let's talk a little bit about these roles. All right, the first one I think is usually the easiest to kind of understand, and it's a prime mover. And a prime mover is exactly what it sounds like. It is the main mover, or the main muscle responsible for producing the concentric movement. And these will be the muscles that are using the most energy for that movement, and this will be the most forceful of the contractions. Usually there is just one prime mover, but occasionally there can be two. The antagonist will oppose the action of the prime mover. And not saying I oppose, I'm not going to let it happen. It just will have more of an opposite action of the prime mover. So while the prime mover is concentrically contracting, the antagonist will be eccentrically contracting, or lengthening, in order to allow an efficient prime movement. So say the biceps brachii, which we're looking right here, is the prime mover, and one of its main actions will be flexing that elbow joint, so decreasing the angle right here. But you cannot have the triceps brachii, which is on the posterior side, or the opposite side of this muscle, it'd be back behind the humerus. You can't have that triceps brachii on the other side also powerfully shortening and concentrically contracting at the same time. So it would need to eccentrically contract or lengthen in order to allow for that flexion of the elbow joint. So inflection of the elbow joint, and we'll talk about this in much more detail in upcoming videos. Inflection of the elbow joint, the biceps brachii would be the prime mover, and the triceps brachii on the posterior side of the arm would be the antagonist. All right, let's talk fixators. Fixators. We have a nice image kind of showing this here. But let's focus again on the fixator. So the fixator is going to be a muscle that will typically, or most typically, will steady a proximal part of a limb. And this will help to allow more clean and efficient movements on the distal portion of a limb. And these are more isometric contractions. So there's contraction occurring, there's tension occurring, but no movement occurring on that proximal end. So it's kind of, you know, keeping that proximal end in place in order for me to be able to forcefully contract some of the muscles on the more distal end. Synergists often complement the actions of a prime mover. Not saying nice things, haha. But what I'm saying, what I mean more here is that it will complement by providing a weaker or less energy consuming contraction that will increase the movement occurring with the prime mover. And there can be many synergists assisting a prime mover for any specific action. So a lot of times, if you're making a list of all the muscles that could, say, flex the knee, you wouldn't just have one muscle. You would typically have a list of, you know, four or five muscles, particularly in some of those bigger joints that could play a role. So you would have one muscle that's the prime mover, that's using the most energy in terms of that contraction and allowing it to happen. And then you have three to four other muscles that are playing a smaller synergistic role to the prime mover. So let's think through these concepts with a question. What type of a contraction would a muscle be doing if it were the prime mover for that action? So that's kind of oddly worded. Basically, what I'm asking, what type of contraction occurs with a prime mover? Is it shortening, like what happens for a concentric contraction? Or is it lengthening, like an eccentric contraction? Or is it no movement, like an isometric contraction? And hopefully you are thinking in this area here with concentric contraction or muscle shortening. Eccentric contractions or lengthening would be more antagonistic, whereas isometric contractions would be more characteristic of fixators. All right. Thanks for all your attention. Regarding the skeletal muscle tissue, we are going to start getting into some of the gross anatomy now. We're going to start talking about specific bones. We're going to start talking about specific joints. We're going to start talking about specific muscles. And as you might imagine, there are a lot of all of those. So we have a lot of fun things to pack through, and a lot of the terminology that we've covered in these first three topics will really help with those conversations. Again, thanks for all your attention, and please have a great rest of your day.